विल वाइंड अप विद द थ्योरी द अपकमिंग वीक प्रैक्टिकल्स. Yes, Rijit sir, you missed yesterday's class. No worries on it. Recording is not available, but I'll explain you the concepts. You know, we'll arrange some rescheduling or if some possible. Okay. No worries on it. So I hope screen is also visible. Yeah. Let me just not in Edmodo. So the following class will be this is the first material that we'll refer today. And apart from this, there is a PDF that we are going to refer. There is a reference material. How we had done in case of the UK and Indian laws. So, crime scene information management will be the topic. Okay. So generally we understand about crime and crime scene, cyber crime, investigation, the procedures, the evidence handling, concepts of evidence handling, the documentation and everything we just saw. Apart from that this is something which is quite important to manage all these kind of things. Crime scene information management. Mainly what happens is private investigators follow in any of these two categories. Broad, whatever the case may be, this will be the ultimate two category in any of these where the investigator is falling into cases involving the legal system. This is involving client requests outside the legal system. So one is about involving the legal system and one is about client involving outside the legal system. Just give me a minute. Yeah. Either the investigator will go and touch the legal aspect, legal parts, or it will start the things which are not into the legal system and they are privately requested. Wherein law enforcement agencies are not supposed to be involved. These type of assignment are usually initiated by private citizens and not necessarily connected to the legal systems. Examples of these cases include missing person. And we have, in the last module, we have a case study on missing person, no evidence. Right. So your client could be looking for a long lost friend, someone who, owes them a money or a runaway spouse, or they are a missing teenager who skipped town to live with her, boyfriend, girlfriend, just as a case scenario it's taken. Cases involving suspected infidelity, your client may want to confirm for personal reasons that their spouse is having an affair. Again, this was a case study we had already previously discussed. If your client wants to gather evidence to present in court to justify a divorce filing, this means that now the case involves legal system. Before that, it's outside the legal boundaries. Correct? When you have these kind of assignments, it is important to have a clear and direct communication with your client and know exactly what they want. As a good PI, you'll give your client a straightforward and a realistic assessment on how you can deliver and what your client can expect. Cases involving the legal system are certain examples. These type of assignments involve conducting an investigation to gather evidence for presentation in a court. In the court of law or other formal legal proceedings. When you start out as a PI, these are the most likely common types of cases you will work for. For this, it's imperative that you understand the laws to apply your case, right? That's the reason we studied about a bit of laws also. Although it depends on the geographical area, you should know about those laws also. So one is law offices, insurance companies, government investigation cases, accountants, business with a fraud or loss prevention department. These are some of the involving legal IT. Understanding how the law applies to these kind of specific cases determines the level and the quality of evidence you must obtain to be successful for your client. It can also determine how you obtain this evidence. Let's illustrate for this one. say a client phones up to you and says, you know, she's suspicious. She's suspicious that her husband is having an affair with his secretary on their lunch hours. I mean, just a case example. Infidelity cases are one of the most common types of PI. I mean, trust me, even being in a PI, you know, firm, PI organization, monitoring the kids and monitoring the spouses is the most common type of cases we get. She wants to gather evidence for the use in court to file for a divorce. At this point, you check the law in your state about what evidence is needed to support reasonable suspicion of infidelity. The law says that to have a reasonable suspicion, the parties must fulfill all the following conditions. They must be at a location where they can commit the act. They must have sufficient amount of time and they must have inclination. Here, this is given because they had a professional relationship at work for years, right? Now you can translate your understanding of the law into a successful plan of action. You tail the husband and the secretary to a hotel room on their lunch or snap a time, stamp the photo of them. I mean, this is something in this general crime it's going as of now, but in terms of cyber, there are a lot of possibilities, as in, you know, if the wife can provide the husband's phone for a few hours, or, you know, for a specific time frame, telling the wife to, you know, have the husband's phone. And we ourselves are installing some kind of monitoring or tracking software and reading out the chats and all, right? I mean, these are the case scenarios that can be added in terms of cyber then, right? So, pre and post martial are the most cases handled. Exactly. This is the absolute truth. The strength in understanding applicable laws means you also know what you have to do and what you have to not do. Otherwise, it will be something being, you know, saying yourself, I'm a PI, PI, you are only done something illegal and you are behind the bars. The case is, you know, the case has gone, leave the case apart only, but you yourself are, you know, inside then. This will save you a lot of time and effort and help you to define the parameters of your investigation. You don't need to sneak around to take pictures through windows. You don't need to, you know, install hidden videos or audio devices. You don't need a physical evidence left behind either by the husband or the secretary. You don't need any statements from the secretary or a husband. We are not a law enforcement officer over here, right? You only need to gather, you know, convince one judge. You don't need to, you know, convey multiple people on a jury. So, I mean, again, repeated slide, sorry. Example of internal investigation. Again, consider another example. You know, most large companies have internal investigation departments. If a store is consistently, you know, coming up short on products or the cash during audits, or if it suspects that employees are stealing time, clocking out early and taking long breaks, it will reach out to a PI. When conducting an internal, and this is the most second category where PI get cases. It's again one of the most increased category. I mean, these are the kind of cases with a PI that a PI can get the most. This is on the second, you know, internal investigation, corporate investigation, right? So when conducting an internal investigation, the first thing you will do is speak with the owner or the main manager to establish exactly why they have hired you. Set their expectations for you that you can deliver, get to the work on your investigation. This could mean interviewing many employees or not even interviewing, staying, you know, staying stealthy, reviewing personal records, looking over old security camera footage, computer forensics, installing surveillance equipment, a lot of other things, looking for insider threats, a lot of things are involved then. In terms of cyber, then a lot. Corporate investigation, a lot of things are involved. And trust me, although we are going to discuss about a few things to start your career as a PI, but I'm just giving you, you can say, a lead over here, a hint over here. Try to get corporate investigation cases. Try to go into corporate investigation because, to be very honest, number one, that's where you will learn many aspects of technology in terms of cyber. Number two, the most important part, corporate investigation is the, you know, source where more money is there, wherein you can get a sustainable amount of money, even more than sustainable amount, right? regardless that you are able to reach to a conclusion or not, you are charging for your time. Simple as that. That is why, you know, corporate investigations are preferred. I mean, my suggestion, personal opinion, not any, you know, some kind of points to it, personal opinion, you can say. Your ultimate goal is to conduct a thorough investigation that sheds light on any wrongdoings. Go about your investigation with an eye towards gathering the evidence that would support criminal or civil charges. Should the employer decide to take any employees to the court, usually you can determine who your main suspects are by conducting good interviews with all employees in the target department. You can, and if you can make a decent case against even one person as a skilled PI, chances that you are make that employee squill on others, right? Once you have gathered all your evidence and organized the relevant employee statement, you'll write up a final report for your client. This should include recommendations for avoiding employee problems in the future. Depending how your client decides to proceed with your findings, you may be called upon later to testify in the court. The time you'll spend on these type of cases varies among how many people you have to talk to. You can expect to wrap up an internal investigation after 80 to 120 hours of work. It's also common to be hired solely for the purpose of conducting in-depth background checks on potential employees. Background verification, right? We understood that part also, that as a PI we can do that. Then in terms of cyber, again the cases can go up to hours and hours of long, depending upon how many systems are affected and all. Right, and then you have to create up a report. Example of interviewing and questioning case. Always bring a notepad and a recording device and make sure that you explicitly have the subject's consent and maintain the proof of this to be recorded. Video cameras are better because they also convey the body language. Some people are talkers that are usually helpful. There are many methods to break the ice and gaining the trust with someone when you are interviewing. This is what is known as social engineering. Okay. I mean, I am saying this because I've been working into field of social engineering since the day I'm into cybersecurity, since 4 years. And this usually involves establishing a common personal connection. When you are on safe and easy subjects, you want to ask your subject question that you already know the answer to, such as where they grew up, where they went to school, and so on. If you have been informed of a specific neutral details about the subject, for example, they like red socks because they knew someone who was, you know, personal trainer for their team. Ask them questions that will lead them to tell you this information. Pay attention to their body language and speech patterns as they do this. What you are doing is establishing what it looks like when this person is telling the truth. Once you have established your trust and a personal connection, you can move on to the more difficult questions. If you feel that you are losing your subject's trust, you can move backward to neutral topics and take some pressure off. Since you know that your subject's body language and responses are like they are telling the truth, you can also detect when they may be lying. This can help you to shape the direction of your overall investigation. And these kind of questioning and interview and this social engineering, very important in terms of cyber also. Very important. Right? Very important in terms of cyber. Manipulating the human mind. It's a very lethal threat. At the same time, you can use this skill to, you know, use it for a good work. Okay. For example, very layman example, and probably you people may laugh. Very layman example. 50 employees are there. Along with the IR audit and the, you know, phishing exercise. Example that I heard from, concluded out in a webinar is, ask a simple set of question in the form of cybersecurity awareness, asking that how many of you people are actually aware, you know, people are using their names as their passwords. The first letter is capital. For example, it's Urvesh. So it's U capital URVESH and birth date as 11, right? So Urvesh 11 or Urvesh Thakkar 11. And using a special character at the end, Urvesh Thakkar $11, right? So how many of people have seen these kind of things where people are using their name along with their birth dates and the dollar sign, people using their mobile numbers, people using their spouse name. And, you know, out of 50, there are, you know, 45 to 48, you know, like raising their hands, like saying, yes, right? Why? Out of that 45 people that are saying yes, out of those 45, minimum 25, 30 are the ones who have actually done it. And that's the reason they are saying yes. Simple social engineering trick, right? And this is how, you know, it's, you know, manipulating the human brain. Important in terms of investigation also. And very important in terms of cyber crime, because these days, the threat actors are not hacking, you know, your servers or hacking neighbor's Wi-Fi. Cyber criminals don't need to hack neighbor's Wi-Fi because they already have a good Wi-Fi than the neighbor also. So they are criminals. The only thing that cyber criminals are targeting these days is the human mind. Right. So social engineering is another perspective that you can include over here. How many people fall for this? Quite a lot of people fall for this. Quite a lot. You can go and try this out in a crowd. Okay. I tried it out at many places. I tried this out. I tried it out in various schools. 8th, 9th, 10th standard folks. Okay. 50, 60 people. Out of which, you know, almost out of 100, you can say, 85 to 90 students are, you know, saying yes. And actually, out of those 85 to 90, 60, 70 are the ones who have actually done it. That's the reason. Because that's an adrenaline rush, right? Yes, why? Because they are getting excited to say yes due to the fact that they are relating themselves with that example. Right? So, tricking the mind. Probably not. See, for the ones who have attended the webinars, these kind of things, they know. But you can just, you know, go and try. At least 50% will be there for sure. Right, so it's not a point. I mean, as per whatever webinars and experience I have gained in this, I don't think so. Yeah, there may be a few, there may be a certain percentage of those people, you know, paling me, but not the maximum crowd is of the one which are actually, you know, being into the trap, because that is how the human mind is playing a role over here, right? Initially, the human mind is not smart enough to, you know, think of this. And what you can expect, especially from the people who are not even from the technical background. And yeah, this is a PDF. The link for this is already been attached over here. And this is the PDF that you are going to refer now. For case management. By case file. Okay, this is the page where we are going to start with. Just a minute, I'll just open it with some other text. Open with WPS. This is around 34 page. Okay. Not that big, but useful to know. Will be shared with you. This is all about managing the case management assets. There are a few points that we are going to look at this, which are quite important in terms of case management. What are the things that you require in case management? Okay. Number one, the very first thing is the client and the case itself. Probably you have heard of this. You know, it's not a joke, but it's an inspiration kind of a thing wherein a person is asking, what do you need to climb a mountain? Some are saying in order to climb a mountain, we need ropes, we need boots, we need mountaineering equipments, right? We need some kind of, ropes or, you know, pathway or staircases to climb a mountain. But the actual answer is, in order to climb a mountain, you need a mountain itself. Right, how you will climb the mountain. Similar, understanding case management, you should have a client and the case itself first. And then you should focus on the management assets. The reason, very first, client and the case. Without a client who has the need, you won't be able to solve a case. You won't get a case at all. All cases start with first contact with the client and proceed from there. I mean, in this, you know, this people have said that, you know, there are a few ways that a client and case is covered in this particular book. When you first take a case, this extra info makes a difference in the world and how the case will proceed. We'll cover client data. So, you know, just client data, we'll just focus on these three, these terms. Client data. The first player in your case is the client. Get as much information about them in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the thoughts on how and why? The client data sheet. Work order.
Okay.
We are going to see a reference document. This also loaded in this PDF itself. Your case begins. See, this is very important in terms of documentation. This is, I mean, this is important. Whatever we are discussing as of now is very important in terms of starting a case from scratch and reaching out to an end.
Case management.
Very important, right?
Right, sir.
If you are not able to manage the case, you cannot say yourself as a
PI.
Even if you're not able to crack up the case, your management
will
show up that how efficiently you have worked on
it.
Your case begins with a very first client contact. Detailed client information. In order, you can get so much information about the client as possible from the client about themselves and the case itself. Gathering this information saves a lot of time and the long run task, which is more impressive to the client. As per the client requirement. After all, they are hiring a detective or a PI. The task questions and take notes from the beginning is reassuring. Right? Knowing more about the client case up front makes it easier to formulate how you need to work upon the case. Who you could assign it to, what resources you need to utilize. This is very vital formulating your retainer amount, some of the items that you want to include in your client contact sheet. Basic contact info, place of employment, secondary contact, personal identifiers. Personal identifiers, they are nothing but privately related to
followers.
One thing I'd like to add a point. You cannot collect personal identifiers without the consent of the client.
Main game walk
from anyone.
एक बार फॉलोअर्स
The very basic info, so you'll need how to classify the investigation, the releases. If your specialty requires certain releases or other forms for the from the client, list them here. Other parties involved, communication security, how you can and cannot communicate with the client, what are the other methods secure, what's the confidential, is the talks maintained and it's between you and your client, or walls are also hearing it and the walls are forwarding it to someone else. The case number, there is a specific methodology also to write the case number also. I mean, depends on case to case, but I'll just come to that also if required. Case number format. So, getting detailed information about the client service if you didn't need. One of the most cases you'll need, why the client wants information, or you'll want to verify the legitimacy of their position in the investigation. Having good intel on your client lets you in due diligence before working on the case. To some civil cases,
years,
and it's easy for you, you know, to contact the client and vice versa for the better.
Three,
sometimes when you have to turn a client over to collection because they haven't paid their bill. The more info you have about the client, the more easy for the process. Note, you want to keep some information about the client available while in the field, but you want to keep it secure. One thing to keep in mind is use the case number as the label on the file jackets, top of the forms, etc. Another option to code some of the sensitive information is the hard copy file that you take to the field. That if you inadvertently allow prying guys to see the documents, you are still keeping the identity of your client confidential. Also, if you are if you have a computer with you or store data on a smartphone, be sure to use the passwords. Creating a case number. This is important in terms of, you know, using the forensic tools also, because almost every forensic tool says you create a case number, right? So create a case number at the first client contact if you think there is a chance that you will get the case. This gives you a tool to identify and reference the rest of your files, and this one little step will pay itself over and over as you proceed with an investigation. So case number formatting, how it could be, as I was saying, you know, there is some formatting also. What I'll do is, I'll just keep certain things in this document for you to self-read. Is it okay, or shall I go on with the entire reading? Certain things, self-read. Yeah, but other things I'll just discuss. The entire document won't be able to self-read. How many of you read the UK and India's comparison of cyber laws, that entire PDF? Tell me honestly. How many of you went through that? None. And you want me to allow this as a self-read? Go through that. I have to schedule it. Test on it. Trust me, before we start off with the practical, there will be tests, assignments scheduled on every theoretical, the one main theoretical topic that we had covered so far. Okay, without that, I won't start the practical. So make sure you read the self-read content also. That is what you all had agreed, right? During the demo platform and the quizzes and the assignment, right? So there will be quizzes and assignments on the previous theoretical topics before we start off with the practical. Make sure you go through certain areas in this PDF. I'll keep them as self read, right? This is something you're going to self refer as a reference. Okay. Now, basic case information. This part, you know, case number format, you can go through it. Always get as much as case information from the client you can possibly from the very beginning and get it in writing. Not only this is important step, it illustrates a crucial concept, that is, if it's important to enough to do, it's important enough to write down and create a standardized list. Trust me, this documentation what we're referring to as of now, it's not in terms of general crime scene, just it's important in terms of cyber crime also. The process is the same regardless of the which type of case you're involved. As the saying goes, the dullest pencil has a better memory than a sharpest pen, right? So writing is important. If you haven't done so yet, you should create forms, checklists and templates that prompt you to gather. So I'll share you some checklists also. PI checklists. Don't worry on that. I'll share you some checklists. You know, these are important to gather necessary information related to the specific types of cases you work. Right? Have a checklist sheet for gathering case background information does several things. First, it makes you look more prepared and professional. As I said, even if you don't solve a case properly, if you're not leading to a particular conclusion, but your management skills will show how much you are efficient in solving. Second, it saves time since you are sure to get all the information you need on the first prep. Third, for the seasoned investigator, worksheet provide an organized place to list all the info that you already know to gather. And fourth, it allows you to assign cases to the less experienced investigators because with detailed worksheet, everything they need to do is laid out over there, right? So if you are a senior, if you have some, you know, trainees underworking you, checklist will help them. Then agreements. Oops, sorry, someone is typing. No. Agreements. Once you have a client and a case, your next step is to make absolute sure and certain that everyone is on the same page about the goals of the case, how the investigation is to be conducted, the roles of investigator and the client throughout this entire process, how the report is to be submitted, and the details of the financial relationships. Right? The retainer over here. Retainers are one of the hot button topics of discussion at a variety of PI gatherings. At InfoQuest, I mean, this is the company who have made this. Let's not read that part. Maybe it's a retainer. So we vary the retainer policy based on the client and the type of the case. For example, we have attorneys. We regularly work on the cases. We don't require a retainer from them. For example, if I just want to say, our goal is to make you think and give you options. I mean, according to the document, thoughts and questions about retainer policies. If the retainer is paid by, check, will you require the check? The spelling is typo over there. Check the bank before the case begins. Is there any part of your retainer going to be refundable or non-refundable? Safety zone time prefers to protect you from refunding portions of the retainer if the initial retainer bounces. Right. This is something regarding retainer. These points you can go through for a self-read. Contract. The most important piece of paper associated with the case is the contract. Make sure yours protects both you and the client and help to streamline the case and spelling out such details as overall case goals, the case limitations, and the payment agreements. Okay. Again, the template and all is provided in this book itself. However, this is one of the document that you want to go over with your attorney and your account. Make sure you have dotted the I's and crossed the T's and covered well. I mean, you should know all the points should be listed well efficiently in the contract. Whenever it is possible, have the contracts notarized from a notary. This will prevent some disagreements that may arise with some clients. To convey the importance of the contract and help enhance you the professional image in this career, consider having your contract produced at a print shop on some better paper than just your average office copy paper, or have the contract made attached with carbonless copies. So would you keep the signed original? If you go through this route, be sure contract matches. So I mean, what I have seen doing is, instead of using plain paper, we use yellow color or green paper on which good quality green paper on which this kind of yellow or bordered papered white paper only, but with a bordered with company's logo and brand and carbon copy enabled, so that one copy is with the client and one copy, the original copy, is with us at my organization. I'm saying of, if you have contract professionally printed, consider having as much as set of fees, rates and percentage that you regularly charge printed on the contract, rather than leaving a blank. This lets your client know that these are your fees and that's it. Otherwise, leaving empty blanks make it look like some things are negotiable or you may overcharge. Negotiation is everywhere, right? People just do so. Better to mention this is a fixed cost. Simple. Make a photocopy of the contract to be working document to the file with some of your data or to the report, but keep the original document safe and secure with other contracts. These are the terms. Clauses and details to be considering in your contract. These are some of the terms that must have terms in the contract. Again, go for a self-read. Confirmation letter. One of the simplest and the most overlooked case management element is the confirmation letter. Very few things are as important as the start of the case as clarity and the good way of communication between you and the client. Having a good, solid mutual understanding, especially in terms of writing, serves the both parties well and prevents trouble, to be honest. naturally, the first place you won't have to everywhere spelled out in the contract. The confirmation letter serves as a redundant backup. In short, when in doubt, write it out. Simple as that. After the initial client meeting, I mean, it's all about, you know, the confirmation letter that, you know, you are confirming to hire you in adherence of the particular case that the client is requesting you and all, right? And a few of the points are, you know, added over here that, you know, check your professional stationery and spelling and the grammar and everything is correct. So in case of if the contract, even after contract, the confirmation letter is, you can say, a second proof that you can, you know, justify in terms of writing. Right? Situation. I mean, this is something which I'll, you know, suggest you to go for a self-read. Okay, the definition of situation and all. The helpful information tool also. The case cover sheet. Okay. This is very important in terms of, you know, missing person case. Okay. Known as the questionnaire or the case cover sheet. What are the list of questions? The background check authorization questions and consider this as a kind of a partial checklist only. Information items to look for: official reports, media coverage, maps, photographs. Information items to look for in terms of cyber: do consider OSINT, open source information. Engineer, see, I'm not reading, it's not something I'm skipping, it means it's a part of self-read. Okay. This is something regarding engineering, the master case rooster game planning. It's kind of a strategy that is being followed. I can go through that. Files and forms. Another opportunity for you to increase your efficiency, image and income is through careful construction of detailed yet easy to use. Do we have this in Edmodo? Not yet. It's yet to be uploaded. But I'll sharing before the today's class, I'll share this on Skype. And yes, Edmodo also will be uploaded. Another opportunity for you to increase through a short section. This is probably the most important one in this book. The best thing you can do is invest a good form or a template-based case management package and customize to suit your needs or create your own. So some of the form checklists here, like, you know, work from forms, checklists and templates. Put your word processor to work. There is nothing more than tedious and boring that making forms and checklists, but those are the very crucial and the important things that will, you know, pay you off for your job. Again, read this out. Reasons, you know, why you need work form and, you know, checklist and all. So, you know, less time in organizing. You are well structured, you look more professional, you have everything in writing, all these other points that are contributing. Organize the case file. Once you get your case info from the client, you know what you want to accomplish and start piecing the evidence together. Fill in the blank case file. You will have to do the basic to-do list, a list of people to talk, the databases to search, or the devices to see, the forensic artifacts to check. I mean, depends on the cyber perspective I'm saying as of now. So a few, right? So then again, background, to-do, data notes, Bible hours, communication, I don't know how to spell it. Keep a hard copy of a report, invoice or the other checklist data needed to close the case. Again, these are a few to-do points. Investigation. Now, although this book doesn't tell the process just to investigate, right? We are there to teach that, right? That's the reason we have enrolled for the course. But here are a few of the points, you know, you can just, you know, go through the track, the hours and the dollars, how we can do that, depending. Then the software do's and don'ts. In terms of cyber, it's very important. Backup your data. Letters. The things which I'm skipping, understand that they are for self-read. But before I say them as self-read, make sure you actually do it as a self-read, right? It's not something that I am just, you know, opening the document all of a sudden and showing to you. Whatever I'm saying in the class, especially the reference materials. I have went through those, you know, those documents thoroughly. That's the reason I'm recommending and including in them the courseware, because I know they are quite important, right? But it doesn't mean that, you know, we'll keep discussing this 34 page and, you know, continuing the class for the next 3 or 4 couple of days on this book, right? It's not the point. That's the reason we are going for the self-read. And again, second point is that I'm taking a consent from you all for the self-read, right? Right? You tell me that you want me to cover all these things, no worries. You tell me that you want for a self-read, that's the reason I'm going for the self-read. Consent for you. A consent. See, as an investigator, I'm applying the skill of consent. I'm taking consent from you all for the self-read. Assuming that you all will read it and these questions will be asked in the quiz on Edmodo. Okay. And see, this part over here, it's important in terms of writing the report, the final report, the do's and don'ts. Invoice, the bill that you will give to your client for your work. And at the end of this document, see, there are some sample forms. The client data sheet, a sample form for that is provided over here. Right? So background, MISC info, I mean, these are the general details. Releases, type of the case, case synopsis, client referred by, the duration of the hours, case assigned to client data sheet. Contract of the retainer. This contract agreement is made on this day between your company, agency, by its officer, representative, and the client located at. Who comes up before requesting in the case, and the heading of this as described as the concerning of the case, right? In exchange of your services rendered by your investigation company, the about client agrees of the following terms of retainer and the payment, advance return in the amount of this, you know, money, whatever, so that your company has been paid. And these are the agreement points. Yes. You can just go through them. The nature of investigations.
Yes.
Okay. Agent and the client. This is something that how we will go with the investigation process. What are the tools that, I mean, these are documents, you know, which are very important. Trust me, these are the documents which we do have to make at as a private investigation firm. I've seen these documents very often. Without the nature of evidence, your client won't be assured. You have to, even in terms of cyber, you even have to mention what are the tools that you will be using. Are they paid? Are they open source? Right? What is the credibility of those tools? You can just mention that they are mentioned in the NIST framework, right? Very important points. This nature of investigation. Your client should know that what and how you are going to do. Regardless, they know the technical stuff or no. This is an important document for sure. See, this is a missing person example incident report. All the information regarding the person who is missing, the report, the subject's name, the last seen by, appears to be summary, communications, other communications, last seen date, website, and all the other things. Background verification. Right? You can go and read this out. What are the things? Criminal history, verification of education, driving record, military service, medical history, credit debit card history, CIBIL score in terms of credit debit card, civil litigation history, all these other things are being included over here. Clerical activity checklist. Right? So police reports, forensic disposition of evidence, case final deposition, the case start, and billing and accounting, final communications item from the spreadsheet, right? Witness information. All these other details. Surveillance report. Right, you can see this is in terms of cyber. Incident report, wrongful death. You can just go and refer. Anyways. Apart from that, I have also shared you the other documents that are uploaded in the module 3 folder on Edmodo, the document PDF, wherein you get the document in terms of cyber, I've already uploaded a COC example, chain of custody example over there, right? And let me just share you this. I mean, everything will be uploaded on Edmodo, so it's not a okay. What I'll do is right away I'll upload on Edmodo, but you people are also assured. So if you see Edmodo, well, the fourth folder is already been made. Sorry, the fifth folder. Yeah, I've already added these things. Oops, sorry. So over here, the documents, just a minute. This one and this one. Okay, done on the Edmodo. Let me just check whether it's available for you also. Yeah, done. Okay. So again, I'm repeating over here is the fact that before we start the practical, whatever things that I've said on which I'll take the quiz, that's for sure, this theoretical terms, you know, it's not something that one single test will be combined. I mean, as per the time, what I'll do is I'll create, you know, one or 2 days we will have, and on both the days we'll have, you know, two different tests instead of, you know, combining so many questions together, and then we will move on to the practical. So at least I can be assured that whatever consent I've taken from you for self-read, you have actually self-read it or not, right? So you can, you know, buckle up your seatbelts and start referring to the notes previously. There was already a test taken up once, right? Similarly, there will be two or more three tests for the previous topics. Then we'll move on to the practical aspects. Okay, so it's already almost time is up. We'll wind up over here. And I hope you enjoyed today's class. Any specific questions? Make sure you go through the documents, okay? This is what we are sharing for you for your own reference. Any specific doubts? Or can I get AC all
in the blanks?
Okay, so Sam sir, I've got an okay from you. Others, anyone? All clear, AC, all good, AG? Well, I guess so. All clear. Cool. Go through this document that I've shared today. It's a part of courseware. It will be there in the test also. The law of UK, US also will be there. I mean, before we, when I the test Friday, today is Wednesday, Thursday. Yeah, sir, probably you can expect the test on Friday. Okay? Probably. Or if you know, I think there are a few more topics, you know, a few topics yet, you know, to be covered before we go on to the practical. The CRPC 91 notice. I mean, these are the topics. CRPC 91 is very, it's a part in terms of police investigation. Right. And specifically it's for India. But the similar is the case with other geographical areas, although it's kind of similar notice that they make. Okay. So either on Friday, I'm not well sure, but if not Friday, then from the coming week, the Monday, Tuesday, you know, we will have the tests. Okay. We'll keep it light, sir. Don't worry. It's not some, that's the reason I'm saying na. So the test that we will do is, I'm not looking for a, you know, of 40, 50 MCQs from all the sections, you know, mixed up together. I'm also not looking for that. Okay. We will take two or three tests consecutively. It's okay. But we will have it, you know, that is easy to absorb and easy to digest. Because at the end of the course, we will take a big test, a self-assessment test involving all the modules together. That is the reason I'm saying, sir, don't worry. You know, even if it takes a day or two for us, it's okay. But before we move on to the practical, we will have these tests. Same case with me, sir. Same case with me. The same is the case with me. And whatever will be the area of the test. So for example, there is a test beforehand, I'll inform you. And what are the topics that you need to focus on for the test? Also, I'll just inform you. Okay. So, well, all that from my end for today. Probably we'll start tomorrow with a small topic or directly with CRPC 91. Yes? Okay. Sure. Okay then. Cool. Sure, sir. I'll you know, there won't be a surprise test. No, not at all. I don't like surprise tests either. So, well, that's all from my end for today. Well, I guess you enjoyed this particular class, and I'll directly meet you tomorrow the same time, 10:30, 10:40, in case if there is delay, right? That's all. Okay. So see you tomorrow, everyone. Thanks for joining. Bye. Have a good day. Sam, sir, have a good night. Rest others. Thank you. Thank you.